You'll be very grateful to know that Dr. Kashansky did not ask me to sing this morning. What he did ask me to talk about is the future of pediatric oncology here. But in order for you to truly understand the impact of where we're headed, you need to understand where we were not so long ago. You see, as late as the early 1950s and 1960s, a child with cancer was not expected to be cured. The role of the pediatric oncologist was to make a diagnosis and help a family and a child through end of life. Fast forward a few decades to the early 1980s, when I was diagnosed with acute lymphoblastic leukemia. At that time, doctors were just starting to recognize that if they combined intense therapy with surgery, radiation, and chemotherapy, a few children could be cured. And you may say, what could you have remembered? You were only three. But I will tell you that I remember what I ate for lunch the day I was diagnosed, a fish sandwich, and I do not eat that anymore. I remember having spinal taps and bone marrows while I was awake. My mother would hold me, and we would never do that anymore to a child. And I remember the loss of children from the waiting room who I could no longer play with because they had not been cured of their disease. Fast forward to current day. A child with cancer today has an overall 80 to 90% chance of being cured. Now you may say that's fantastic given what I just told you, but I say it is not nearly good enough. Cancer is still the number one cause of death in children over age one other than injury. And a substantial number of these children have late effects that negatively affect the quality of their life. So what are we going to do about it to cure the remaining 10 to 20%? And how are we going to reduce those late effects? Most pediatric oncologists today would agree we have reached our toxic limits with chemotherapy. We are not going to cure more people using old drugs in new ways. We need to think smart and we need to think new. Luckily, there are several very promising and exciting techniques that we have here at Stony Brook and that we're using in collaboration with investigators across the country and across the world. The first, personalized medicine. Understanding what makes an individual child's cancer different than another child's, even if they have the same disease, and choosing a treatment strategy that allows us to pick the very best one for that child. And if we're lucky, we'll pick a drug that targets the very machinery in the cells that makes their cancer so aggressive, yet leaving the healthy cells of the body unharmed. The second is immunotherapy, harnessing the power of the immune system to recognize that a cancer cell is foreign from a child's body and it should be attacked and destroyed, again, while leaving the healthy cells of the body unharmed. So that brings us to where we're headed in the MART building. We will continue to work tirelessly in the lab, our new state-of-the-art labs, to understand the biology of cancer so that we can then translate those findings to the clinics and try out our new therapies. Because my hope is that one day I could give this talk and we could fast forward a few decades and I will be able to tell you that our new MART building is filled with a waiting room where all children are survivors and none of them have long-lasting late effects and they have a superior quality of life after cancer. I'd like to thank a few people, to all of the hospital administrators and leadership who recognize the importance of cancer care and the MART building. To all of the donors in the room, who without you, this would not have been possible. But most importantly, to the patients and family members in the room who entrusted your loved ones to our care, thank you, because you are the future of MART and cancer care at Stony Brook.